Okay, so I'm Andrei DAVYDYCHEV, and I'm very glad that I have a possibility to take part in this conference in honor of Dirk. So, and my presentation is on geometrical splitting and reduction of N-point Feynman diagrams. I want to start with some very simple slides describing what the Feynman diagram is. And as an example, we can use, say, quantum electrodynamics, where electrons interact using the photons. So elementary interaction vertex is electron emitting a photon. And we can also organize interaction between two electrons using a photon. And also we can have more complicated examples of interaction where we have more photons and some of the photons go from one electron line to another electron line. And in such way, so we can get so-called closed cycles or loops. And one of the examples here is a triangle diagram. And another example is four-point function, which is a box diagram. Now, when we calculate Feynman diagrams, so we are using so-called Feynman rules. So each vertex can have some indices, Lorentz indices, spinor structure, and it's proportional to coupling constant and may depend on the momentum of the particles. Then each line connecting two interaction vertices, it's a so-called propagator, and it has such a form where we have the four-dimensional momentum in the denominator, which basically consists of the energy and of three-dimensional momentum. And this is like a green function for D'Alembert-like equation. And also each closed loop implies integration over four-dimensional momentum K flowing around this loop. But as a result of this integration, we may get divergences. And so we need some kind of regularization to parameterize these divergent things. And one of the most common tools used in loop calculations is dimensional regularization. The idea is to use the space-time dimension, I denote it as a small case n, as a regulator. So we basically introduce some small epsilon to this dimension, which is close to zero. So we change four-dimensional integration into n-dimensional integration. And then if the integrals are singular, then the singularities appear as 1 over epsilon poles. And this is the simple example of tetpole diagram. So for example, nu denotes the power of propagator, and when nu is equal to 1 or equal to 2, so we have divergences. We have a gamma function of epsilon, which basically gives us 1 over epsilon pole. Now, so I'm going to speak about a little bit more general case when we have one loop endpoint function. And it looks like that. So we have basically capital N external legs here. And in physics, this might correspond to the processes, say, M particles to N minus M particles. And in general, when we consider arbitrary external momenta, arbitrary internal masses, so such an integral, even a scalar integral, would depend on half N times N minus one in momentum invariance of such form and N internal masses. So basically the number of variables grows quadratically with respect to the number of external legs. And this is the basically the definition of the integral, scalar integral, scalar Feynman integral corresponding to the n-point function. And it has n denominators like that. And basically we integrate over the loop momentum, which is denoted as q in this case. Now, coming back to Dirk's birthday. So how Moscow, Hobart, and Mainz got connected through Dirk. The story began in early 90s. And at that point, so I lived in Moscow, worked on such endpoint Feynman diagrams using Mellin-Barnes approach, hypergeometric functions, etc. And Dirk worked in Mainz, also known as Mayence, and studied similar Feynman diagrams using also some hypergeometric functions, but he was using Carlson R functions. And in 1992, Dirk invited me to give a seminar at the University of Mainz. And if I'm not mistaken, this was our first meeting. And later on, for 2 years, I was a postdoc in Bergen, Norway, and Dirk went to Hobart in Tasmania. And of course, I mean, many of you know that Australia is called Down Under and Tasmania is under Down Under. And he worked with Bob Delbourgo, and then Dirk returned to Europe, and in next year, in 1996, so I was able to continue research work with Bob, basically within the same project. And this is how the how our work on a geometrical approach to Feynman diagrams was started. So, and also I spent 4 years in Mainz, and of course we had a lot of useful communications with Dirk. So this is how this presentation is related to Dirk. So, and I have basically another 3-point function here. So that's how Moscow, Hobart, and Mainz got connected through Dirk. Now, back to the integral. So let's consider this n-point integral with unit powers of propagators. So normally these are master integrals that we need. And use Feynman parametric representation for this integral. So we have n fold integral with one delta function. So this and alphas are Feynman parameters. So in the standard Feynman parametric representation, so we have quadratic denominator, which contains some quadratic part multiplied by momentum invariance and some linear part multiplied by the squared masses. But we can, using the condition that the sum of alphas is equal to one due to this delta function, we can make the quadratic form homogeneous in alphas. And so basically we multiply linear part by the sum of alphas. And then we can rewrite it in slightly different form where we get these quantities CJL. And CJL can be defined as sum of masses squared minus the corresponding momentum invariant divided by some masses, and they can be associated with cosines of some angles. And when this cosine is equal to one, so this corresponds to two particle pseudo threshold. And when this cosine is equal to minus one, then this corresponds to two particle threshold. And of course, direct geometrical interpretation through the angles and cosines of these angles is possible when the corresponding cosines are between minus one and one. So in this case, the angles tau are real. But in other regions, so we just can consider analytical continuation, and instead of trigonometric cosines, so you get hyperbolic cosines. Simple example of a two-point function. So basically we can associate with two-point function where we have external momentum K12 and internal masses M1 and M2, we can associate a triangle. And this triangle has sides M1 and M2, and the third side is basically the absolute value of the momentum. And also, we will use the perpendicular, which we call M0. So using this perpendicular, so we split our triangle into two rectangular triangles. And just to remind, so the cosine has, the cosine of this angle has such form. Of course, it's just trigonometric identity. And again, I repeat that at the pseudo threshold, so these sides M1 and M2 are together. So the angle tau is equal to zero. And at the threshold, so they just go in different directions. So the angle tau is equal to pi. So this is the geometrical picture associated with this simple diagram. For the three-point function, the situation is a little bit more complicated. So we have three independent external momentum invariants, and we have three masses, and the geometrical picture would give us a tetrahedron, three-dimensional tetrahedron, and we three sides of this tetrahedron are associated with the masses M1, M2, M3, and three other sides shown in red are associated with the absolute value of the external momenta, of the three external momenta. And here also we can drop a perpendicular from this point onto the triangle made out of this momenta invariants. And here we have three angles, and the definition of cosines of these angles is here. If we go to the four-point function, so then we get already a simplex. And this simplex should be understood in four dimensions. So the slide requires four-dimensional imagination. So, and we have four masses, M1, M2, M3, M4. So the diagram itself is shown here. So basically we have four external momenta, but we have six internal external momenta invariants because we also get Mandelstam variables S and T here. And okay, so in the simplex, so we have four masses and we have six momenta invariants. And what is shown in red is in fact a three-dimensional tetrahedron. But the picture itself is four-dimensional because we also have these mass sides. And also here, basically important quantities are Gram determinant, which is the determinant of the matrix of these cosines, D4. And also the basically the Gram determinant corresponding to this red tetrahedron, which I call lambda four. And the hypervolume of this simplex is related to square root of Gram determinant. And the volume of this red tetrahedron is related to the square root of this lambda, which is also Gram determinant. And if we drop a perpendicular from this point onto the red tetrahedron, so the length of this perpendicular M0 would be proportional to the square root of D4 over lambda four. Now, using this geometrical picture, so we try to go from Feynman parameters to the geometrical picture. And on this way, we make some substitutions of variables, linear and quadratic substitutions. And in fact, what we do, we change the argument of the delta function that now it has this quadratic structure, which we used to have in the denominator. And this quadratic structure would be equal to one because it's in the argument of the delta function. This is how we get rid of quadratic structure in the denominator instead. So we put it into the argument of the delta function. But while making this transformation, so we earn some linear denominator, which we have here. And capital C is basically a modified matrix. Basically we have the same cosines, but they are multiplied by some quantities, which are square roots of capital F's, and capital F's are just partial derivatives of Gram determinant multiplied by the corresponding masses. And we can see that, in fact, the vector composed of the square roots of F divided by the masses is an eigenvector of this matrix C. So, and a eigenvalue of this vector is just the Gram determinant. And we also would need the generalizations of lambda, which can be easily generalized in n dimensions, and also the length of the perpendicular, which is still proportional to the square root of these two determinants. Now, we continue to work on the parametric integrals, and now we try to make the quadratic form diagonal. And we do the corresponding rotation and transform this quadratic form to the diagonal form. And if all lambdas are positive, then we can just rescale the betas and get the delta, which corresponds to hypersphere, to the hypersurface of hypersphere. And then the only weight in our integral would be one of the parameters gamma to certain power. And all the rest is basically the measure of integration, nothing more. And all the depend, except for the prefactor, all the dependence on the momenta and masses is in these limits of integration, which is n-dimensional solid angle. And amazing thing is that this n-dimensional solid angle is basically the same solid angle as we have here in basic simplex. So basically by this transformation, so we got the integral where we have the integration over this solid angle, and delta function gives us the hypersurface of the unit hypersphere. So basically we integrate over this piece of hypersphere, which is cut by this solid angle. And also from this expression, we can see that we have special case when the space-time dimension lowercase n is equal to the number of external legs. So then this factor disappears, and basically we have just non-Euclidean hypervolume or content, how mathematicians call it. And this special case, it's basically a two-point case in two dimensions, or three-point case in three dimensions, or four-point case in four dimensions, and so on. And another important question is what happens if some of the lambdas, which we get when we make the quadratic form diagonal, if some of them are negative. It means that in this case, so we would need we would get a hyperbolic surface instead of spherical surface. And all our equations or all our results for these Feynman diagrams can be obtained just by analytical continuation of the results which we get in another region, for example, for the spherical case. Now, again, to compare these two approaches of, or these two representations, this is standard Feynman parametric representation. So we have n-fold integral with one delta function, and it depends on the masses and momenta invariants, basically through these masses and CJL in the quadratic form, which is in the denominator of this parametric integral. In the geometric representation, well, again, except for this prefactor, all the dependence on the masses and momentum invariance is in the n-dimensional solid angle. So it's just here. So there is no dependence left in the integrand. And another important thing is that we can use this geometrical representation for splitting, and I will explain what does splitting mean, and for the reduction of the number of variables in separate pieces of the occurring functions, and basically for the simplification of the result. Now, let's continue with the two-point function. So this is the basic triangle associated with our two-point function. Again, we have mass M1, M2, and the absolute value of the momentum. And our integration will go over a circle, unit circle, basically, over the arc tau 1, 2. So this is the angle tau 1, 2, but if we use the perpendicular here, then this tau 1, 2 would consist of tau 0, 1 and tau 0, 2. So if you point some, if you put some point 0 here. And all the relations, I mean, we get just using trivial trigonometric formulae. And the area, of course, can will be proportional to the sign of this tau 1, 2. Like in usual trigonometric formula. But now what we can do here. So if we now consider new momentum invariants, k01 squared and k02 squared, and of course the square root of k12 squared is equal to these two square roots, then each of the resulting each of the resulting triangles will be rectangular triangle. And the sides of these triangles will satisfy the Pythagorean theorem, of course. And we can split our integral, which would go over this angle tau 1, 2, into two integrals. One of these integrals would go over tau 0, 1, and another integral would go over tau 0, 2. And basically, each of these pieces can be associated with new Feynman integral, but with different momenta, momentum and masses. So we split basically our original integral with k12 squared and m1, m2 into two integrals. The arguments are shown here, but what's important that now these arguments of each of these integrals satisfy the Pythagorean theorem. So now not all three of them are independent, but just two of them are independent. So effectively, we reduce the number of variables. So if this integral dependent on three variables, now both integrals on the right hand side depend only on two variables. Now, of course, I mean, one of the variables we can just use as the dimension. And if we speak about the dimensionless variables, this means that in the original integral, we had two dimensionless variables. And in each of the resulting integrals, we have one variable less. So starting with two-dimensionless variables, we end up with one-dimensionless variable. And if we look at the quadratic form in the Feynman parametric integral, so the original one was this one. But in each of the resulting integrals, we can use this Pythagorean theorem. And we get, for example, in one of the integrals, we get just such expression, which has two terms instead of three terms here. And we can easily calculate the integral with such denominator, which gives us in arbitrary dimension just the f to one hyper, just Gauss hypergeometric function. Now, the three-point case. Again, so let's try, remember we have this special case when the space-time dimension is equal to the number of external legs. And here, basically in this special case, our result for Feynman integral is just the area of spherical triangle, which is the spherical excess. And if we consider these dihedral angles psi, so this would be just the sum of this psi minus pi. And this result corresponds to the result obtained by Bernie-Nickel in 1978. So we just reproduce the result, his result in this simple case. But in general case, when we have arbitrary space-time dimension, so we basically follow this geometrical procedure. So first we drop a perpendicular from this point onto the red triangle, which is composed of the momenta invariance. And this is the picture, basically, this is the spherical triangle or spherical or hyperbolic triangle. So basically the integration goes over this spherical triangle, but the solid angle is defined by this tetrahedron. So basically we have dual picture. Now, so we drop this perpendicular. So let's call this point zero. Then we connect it with each of the vertices of this red triangle, and we get corresponding connections in this picture as well. And basically we split our original tetrahedron into three tetrahedra. And in each of these tetrahedra, we have extra two conditions on the variables which we get. Now, just take one of them, say this lower one along the points 1, 2, and 0, and split it again into two tetrahedra. So now, I mean, our original tetrahedron is split into six tetrahedra, but by dropping this perpendicular, so we get an extra condition on the, again, due to this Pythagorean theorem. And if we look at the number of variables, then in the original one, in the original three-point function, we had six variables, but one of them can be extracted as dimensions. So we get five dimensionless variables in the original one. After the first splitting into three tetrahedra, so we get two relations. So now each resulting each of the resulting integrals depends only on three independent variables, dimensionless variables. And after the second splitting, so we get one extra relation, so each of the integrals depends only on two dimensionless variables. Starting from five, we get two, but we have six pieces. And the original quadratic form of in Feynman parametric integral was this one, containing six terms. And if we take one of these lower tetrahedra, so quadratic denominator would contain just three pieces. So, and this is basically an illustration. So we started with five, basically we reduce the number of variables by three. So we go from five variables to two variables. And using this representation with quadratic denominator containing just three terms, so we can easily calculate it and we get for the general space-time dimension, we get the result in terms of upper hyperparametric function of two variables. And by the way, all these arguments of the occurring hypergeometric functions have very transparent geometrical meaning. So basically, if you look at this picture, so it's just the length of corresponding line. And that's it. Okay, and now for the four-point function. So for the four-point function, so we have this simplex in four dimensions, and we have certain hyper-solid angles, so to say, at this vertex. And what this solid angle cuts out of hypersphere is a non-Euclidean tetrahedron, in fact, which might be spherical tetrahedron or hyperbolic tetrahedron, depending on our external invariants. And so I'm trying to make this picture here, which should be also understood in it's a three-dimensional non-Euclidean tetrahedron, basically either spherical or hyperbolic. And now we also begin the splitting to reduce the number of variables because we have too many variables in the general case. In the general case, we have four masses and six momenta invariants. So we have 10 variables, so we have nine dimensionless variables. So let's do the splitting. So first we drop a perpendicular from this point onto this red tetrahedron. So their intercept is just one point. So because this is one dimensional object, this is three dimensional object in four dimensions. So their intercept is just a point. And this point corresponds to a certain point we inside this non-Euclidean tetrahedron. Now, we connect this point to all the vertices of this red tetrahedron. And also here we get corresponding lines. And now, we can, so basically we split the original tetrahedron into four tetrahedra. Now we take one of them, for example, this lower one, and drop a perpendicular from this point to the base of this tetrahedron. Now we split it into three tetrahedra. So we split the original one into four. Now we split this one into three. And at each step of splitting, we get extra conditions due to this Pythagorean theorem because we always drop the perpendiculars. So we use this Pythagorean connection many times. So now take one of the resulting tetrahedra, this one, for example, and drop another perpendicular from this point to this point, to this point, to this side. So, and basically, this is what we get. So, we split it, the original tetrahedron into four, then into three, and then into two. So basically, we split it into 24 tetrahedra, four times three times two. So, and now let's look at the number of independent variables in each of the pieces. In the original one, so we had 10 variables minus one dimension, so it's nine dimensionless variables. After the splitting the original tetrahedron into four tetrahedra, so we get three relations in each of the resulting pieces, so we get six independent variables, dimensionless variables. After the second step, we get four dimensionless variables. And after the last step, we get three dimensionless variables in each of the resulting 24 pieces. So starting with nine dimensionless variables, so we end up by the functions which depend only on three dimensionless variables each. So we got rid basically by six of them. And if we look at the quadratic form in Feynman parametric integral, so the original one had 10 terms. And if we just take one of these two, for example, this tetrahedron, so then the corresponding denominator has just four terms instead of 10 terms. And you can also see that normally we have partial sums of these Feynman parameters multiplying the corresponding invariants. And this looks like a general feature. So I will discuss it a little bit in the general table. We can basically for each of these integrals, so we can calculate the, we can get exact result in arbitrary dimension, and it would be certain case of Lorenz-Chelle-Sarron function, so Fn. So here is the definition of this function, but it depends on three dimensionless variables. So like we calculated by this Pythagorean theorem. And here is the table showing the reduced number of variables for 2, 3, and 4 point function. And also it can be easily generalized to arbitrary endpoint function. So total number of dimensionless variables is 2, 5, or 9. And this is the total number for endpoint function. The number of pieces in how many simplexes we split our original simplex is 2 in the 2-point case, 6 in the 3-point case, 24 in the 4-point case. And one can easily see that each time we just multiply it again, so we get n factorial in the general case. And the reduced number of variables is 1, 2, 3, and in general case it would be n minus 1. So we started with the number of variables quadratically growing here, and we ended up through this geometrical method by linearly growing number of variables. And also if you look at the quadratic forms, so again, we see that, there is a general feature that we get these partial squares of partial sums of Feynman parameters. Okay, so now the summary. So we suggest, we propose this geometrical way to calculate dimensionally regulated Feynman diagrams. all our momenta squared and masses acquire direct geometrical meaning. And we also get this hypersolid angle, which gives us all the information about the dependence on the momenta squared and the masses. In the one-loop endpoint case, so we can relate the results to certain volume integrals in the non-Euclidean geometry, and of course, it could be either Lobachevsky case or Schlefly case, so we can study this, but it depends, basically it depends on our momenta variables and the masses. And analytic continuation so can be done from basically from spherical case to hyperbolic case. And in a number of cases, so the results of the epsilon expansion. So we get hyperdramatic functions, but still we need to consider epsilon expansion if you want the results for physical quantities. So some of them can be presented in terms of generalized polylogarithms. In more complicated cases, so we can get multiple polylogarithms and so on. But we didn't consider the epsilon expansion in this presentation. Geometrical splitting gives us basically straightforward way to reduce general integrals to those with lesser number of independent variables. And the resulting integrals can be calculated and can be expressed in terms of hypergeometric functions. And here are the types of hypergeometric functions that we get here. And also, maybe the last slide, so I want to mention that there are several papers right now which use geometrical methods, maybe similar to this one, maybe sometimes slightly different from this one. So I tried to collect some of them, but certainly I couldn't get all of them. So my apologies if I forgot something, so you can tell me if I forgot something here. But there are many people working basically using some of these methods. So thank you.
Thank you, Andrei. Thanks very much. Thanks for all the time you've put into these nice pictures. I have one question just quickly. You mentioned in the end that you did not discuss the epsilon expansion, but what you did say is that you refer to dimensions, right? You had formulas with the hypergeometrics and arbitrary dimension. So I was wondering, because at the beginning you said there's something special about the two-point function in two dimensions, the three-point function in three dimensions, and so on, these cases, where it seemed like the dimension should be something very specific. And now you said that you can actually do it in all dimensions. So I was just wondering if you could explain a little bit.
Well, I think in one of these papers, maybe in this one, this case of space-time dimension equal to the number of external legs was explicitly considered for arbitrary number. I think it probably was this one, but I need to refresh my memories. But if we look at the expressions here, so basically, let me see. Yes, so basically what we can see here in the geometrical representation, when n lowercase is equal to the number of external legs, so basically what we have, so this denominator disappears, because it's to the power zero, basically. And what we get is basically just the hypervolume of this piece of hypersphere, which is cut out by our solid angle. So say if we consider four-point function, so this is the volume of the spherical or hyperbolic tetrahedron without weight factors. And this is the property also in higher dimensions. So for example, for the four-point functions, it's a three-dimensional non-Euclidean tetrahedron. For the five-point function, it would be four-dimensional simplex. But again, it would be the hypervolume or content, how you call it, and so on. So we will not get any weight factors like that. So the situation is simpler, but the problem to calculate such quantities, it's still a complicated problem.
Yeah. So and you're saying that this geometric decomposition applies no matter if this factor is there or not.
Right? I mean, we know what does it mean geometrically.
Yeah.
But geometrically, even calculation of the volume of three-dimensional non-Euclidean tetrahedron is a complicated task. So it's solved, but it was a non-trivial task to solve it.
Thank you very much. There's a question from David.
Yes, well, really, it's a comment to remind you about a rather interesting geometrical paper that you also wrote in Tasmania with Bob Delbourgo about the volume of three-body phase space, which you interpreted geometrically. Now, that is taking us into elliptic territory. It's the discontinuity of the two-loop sunrise diagram. And since you did that work, there's been a lot of interest in three-loop and four-loop sunrise diagrams. So I found myself last week trying to help Albrecht Klemm understand the four-loop sunrise diagram, working out the volumes of five-body phase space in two dimensions, and going back to your work with Bob to remind myself how to do that. So not only did you make contributions at the one loop level where the multiple polylogarithms arise, but you also opened up this field of elliptics and beyond, which is the subject of many conferences these days.
Okay, thank you, David. Yes, of course, I remember about that paper, but I had just 45 minutes for my, why I didn't include it.
Thank you very much. Let's all thank Andrei again for the talk.
Andrei.
Thank you.